Hi, good morning. Thank you. Thank you for allowing us to present a sneak peek of...
Γεια σας, καλημέρα. Ευχαριστούμε για τη δυνατότητα που μας δίνετε να παρουσιάσουμε ένα απόσπασμα από το This is Reading. Θα δείτε μόνο ένα μικρό απόσπασμα του This is Reading, που είναι πολυμεσική παράσταση και εγκατάσταση που θα παιχτεί στο Reading της Πενσιλβανίας με αφηγήσεις από την πόλη των τεκτενωμένων στην Αμερική, σήμερα, με κομμάτια από τις ιστορίες καθενός εκεί. Ρίχνει φως στην ποικιλότητα του πολιτισμού μας και δίνει ένα τρόπο να αποφορτίσουμε την αίσθηση ματαιότητας που καμιά φορά μας κατατρίχει. Να σας διαβάσω από το mail που μου έστειλε μία μάνα δύο παιδιών, ανήπαντρη, που έψαχνε δουλειά για πολύ καιρό. Διάβασα όσα έγραψε, έβαλα τα κλάματα, διότι το χαμόγελό της, άμα την έβλεπες καθημερινά, και την έβλεπε καθημερινά, δεν άφηνε να φανεί το πρόβλημά της. Πολλοί Αμερικανοί, Αμερικανές έχουν ένα τέτοιο πρόβλημα, και έτσι σκέφτηκα ότι όλοι μας είμαστε πολύ κοντά σε κάποιον που πασχίζει ενάντια στην οικονομική ανασφάλεια, και μου έθεσε άλλα τα ερωτήματα. Γιατί να συμβαίνει αυτό, πώς και συμβαίνει αυτό σε μια χώρα τόσο ευκατάστατη όσο οι Ηνωμένες Πολιτείες. Έτσι άρχισα να επισκέπτομαι το Reading της Πενσιλβανία, που είναι η φτωχότερη πόλη του μεγέθους σε όλη την Αμερική. Παλιά ήταν βιομηχανική πόλη. Έχουμε λοιπόν το φαινόμενο της μετατόπισης του αμερικανικού αφηγήματος περί του αμερικανικού ονείρου. Τα πάντα βρίσκονται σε παρακμή. Στη συνεργασία που είχαμε, μιλήσαμε με όποιον είχε διάθεση να μιλήσει, τρεις δημάρχους, τρεις επικεφαλής αστυνομίας, ακτιβιστές, πρώην εργάτες, βιομηχανία, πάρα πολύ κόσμο τέλος πάντων, αγρότες, εκπαιδευτές, δασκάλους, όλοι λοιπόν πάντα λέγανε το Reading ήταν η πόλη πια στον παρατατικό ή στον αόριστο. Επρόκειτο για ένα χώρο που δεν μπορούσε να χρησιμοποιήσει τον παρόντα, τον ενεστώτα δηλαδή χρόνο, ή τον μέλλοντα. Και είναι μια πόλη μοιρασμένη σε ένα διάλογο, που για να οικοδομηθεί η ενσυναίσθηση και για να προωθηθούν στόχοι, αυτό να το δει κόσμος και κοσμάκης, για να γιατρευτούν τα ραγίσματα, να χτιστούν γέφυρες, να ξεπεραστούν σκόπελοι, να αξιοποιηθούν πολιτισμικοί θεσμοί, να έρθει η αφήγηση ιστοριών στα άτομα αυτά για να μπορέσουν να δρασκελίσουν κάποια κατόφλια, να βρούνε τους κοινούς τόπους, να επεξεργαστούν ένα κοινό λόγο και κοινό λεξιλόγιο, έτσι ώστε η πόλη να ψάξει να δει ποιοι είναι τώρα, ποιοι θέλουν να είναι στο μέλλον. Και συγκροτήσαμε μια ομάδα λοιπόν από ντοκιμενταρίστες, εικαστικούς, μέλη της γραφειοκρατίας και της διοίκησης της κοινωνίας, υπαλλήλους, εργαζόμενους, πολύ κόσμο. Αυτά που ακούσαμε από την κοινότητα ήταν ότι θέλουν κάτι όμορφο, κάτι το θεαματικό, κάτι που να απηχεί τη ζωτικότητα της ζωής τους. Δεν θέλουν την κατήφια μιας υπόμνησης του παρελθόντος ή του παρόντος. Θέλουν κάτι που να ενσταλάζει ζωή στα πράγματα. Έχουμε λοιπόν μαζί μας τον Τόνι Γκέρμπερ, κινηματογραφιστή, και άλλους συντελεστές αυτής της παράστασης. Οι υπόλοιποι έχουν παραμείνει στο Reading, διότι 14 Ιουλίου είναι η μέρα της παράστασης και χτίζουν το σκηνικό και ετοιμάζουν την παράσταση. Είναι αρκετά ονόματα. Σήμερα λοιπόν θα δείτε ένα πολύ μικρό κομμάτι ενός ειδικού έργου που διαμορφώθηκε για τον χώρο όπου θα θεαθεί. Συναρτάται από πολλά πράγματα, χώρο, θέατρο κτλ. Και εδώ πέρα βλέπετε τα κομμάτια 1, 4 και 7. Θα δείτε πως ήταν ο σταθμός πριν την οικονομική κατάρρευση της πόλης, πως ήταν ο σταθμός του τρένου και πως έγινε μετά ένα κέλυφος τα χάλια του και τώρα πως έχει ανακαινιστεί. Οι ηθοποιοί έρχονται από το ακροατήριο για να αφηγηθούν τις ιστορίες τους ένας-ένας.
I was born in Reading in 1963.
1949, July 1st.
1913.
1951.
In the 18th Ward, west of Schuylkill River on a little street off of Lancaster Avenue, only one block long.
Now, my father, Abraham McCracken, he came to Reading in 1929 from Thomasville, North Carolina. Now, he was born in 1865, the year after slavery.
My great-grandmother came right from Poland. They left when the Nazis took over Poland in 1939.
My family moved here from South Carolina when my grandma made what I like to call a career decision to leave the cotton plantation and to work for the textile industries in Reading. She didn't like the way the cotton made her fingers feel, and she didn't want to kill any more chickens, so she was going up to the big city.
They were born in Germany, Pennsylvania Deutsch, and they came here to work and to build a new life.
There were factories in Reading, chain and cable steel mills, textile, and the railroad. Now, my father was fortunate. He started working in construction. He made 40 cents a day, paid 8 cents an hour. So lots of construction was happening, so you would get hired quick, and they would work people till they dropped, and then take them out in wheelbarrows, and the next guy would go in.
I was born in Reading.
I was born in Reading.
I lived on the 500 block of Moss Street, Northeast Reading. Working class families, mostly white folks, row homes. They were absolutely teeny tiny, 13 or 14 feet across. Two stories with an attic and a basement.
We lived in a small little house on 13th and Green.
I lived on Front Street.
It was 346 North Front Street.
1428 Birch Street. The neighborhood was a melting pot for the people. Second generations, third generation. I was first generation because my parents came from Germany. Growing up, people used our neighborhood as a starter neighborhood, and it was mostly German, Italian, and Jewish people. And then the neighborhood changed, and new people came. Italy.
Trinidad.
Puerto Rico.
Poland.
North Carolina.
Dominican Republic.
Romania.
Virginia.
My father worked for the Reading Railroad at age 14 as a telegraph messenger boy. He managed to lie about his age and got a job when he was only 14. And in the early 1930s, he became a ticket agent for the Franklin Street Station. And then the railroad transferred him to the freight side, and he worked for the Reading Railroad for his entire career until he retired in 1967.
Then my father got a job working for the railroad as a red cap, a porter. So he swept floors, he cleaned toilets, he shined shoes, carried bags for people on and off the train. He was self-educated. He had a third grade education, but he taught himself how to read and write. And that's how he survived. And I remember as a young boy going to the train station early in the morning and seeing hundreds of people lined up, you know, reading newspapers.
Those were good days. My first train ride recollection was about 1944. I rode the train from Reading to visit my grandparents in Harrisburg. And we had a wonderful time visiting our grandparents. And on the return trip, I forgot my teddy bear. I left him on the train. And I was heartbroken. And my dad called the Reading help company to ask for help. And a few days later, I received my teddy bear in the mail. The railroad people sent him back. And he was packed in a Hershey candy box with a candy bar.
My father was a commercial painter. My mother worked in the insurance
office. My father was a grocer.
Office.
My mother was a television
producer. I dropped out of college three times. Found my
I worked life. In a chocolate factory, Palmer's.
I was an ordained pastor. Check.
My mother was a seamstress. T-shirt
worked in a
factory.
Steel factory.
The outlet mall.
Security guard, prison.
We
my father was the manager of Penn Hardware until he went bankrupt.
My mother worked at Chicken Factory, and my father
was a secretary, teacher, psychologist. I grew up in a Polish neighborhood.
The neighborhood was all Poles.
And until I was 8, I thought I was Polish. I even talked with an accent. And I remember getting jumped by a couple of white boys in the park. And one of the guys from my street stopped the fight and he said, "Hey, he's Polish. He's one of us." On my block, we were all brothers. But elsewhere, well, we experienced racism, prejudice, and I can recall being in school, grade school, being one of probably two or three blacks in a classroom of 30, and I can remember teachers, you know, not treating us the same, and I can remember hearing things like eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a nigger by the toe, that kind of thing from the teacher. And I don't think that's right, you know? And what we learned about blacks in school was, you know, little black Sambo, and that we were taught that slaves were lazy and shiftless.
We played
stickball,
fast pitch,
hopscotch,
tackle football,
corner stores.
I loved living so close to my family. I could shout down the street to my grandma who lived across the park. And that park, that's one of the nicest places in the city. It's on 3rd and...
Spruce.
5th.
9th.
Reading was wonderful, booming.
Crystal Palace.
Movie palaces.
The Christmas parade.
Fairs.
Oh, golly. My favorite place in Reading was the train station. My father worked there. And what I remember particularly was Jim McCracken. He was a colored man who was a porter at the Franklin Street Station. And for whatever reason, I'm not sure, but he took a liking to me. He was a big man, you know, big hands. And I felt really secure when he took me by the hand and walked me around.
I remember my father was so personable. You know, he didn't make much money, so he really depended on his tips. So it was all about service. And it was service with a smile, you know, and with a certain flair. And the people that, you know, were more personable people got bigger tips and better tips. So that was a lesson that I learned from him. And the fact that he was black in a time when the red caps and the porters were black. And they had to yes sir and no sir and yes ma'am and no ma'am and take a lot of crap. But people respected him. And they knew that if they went to the train station, that Big Jim was gonna watch after them, he was gonna protect them, and they didn't have to be afraid. And I've had lawyers and doctors and judges, you know, come up to me and say, you know, as a small boy, I used to go to the train station. And it was your father
who was the person who gave us the nickels and dimes and quarters and told us to stay out of trouble. It was your dad was there when I arrived in Reading, and I didn't have any place to go, and he told me, you know, who I could talk to and where I could find a place to live and where I could find a job and who would help me. Mm-hmm. And there were people who were doing time. And the only, the stipulation was that if McCracken will be your sponsor, I'll let you out of jail. I'll let you out of prison. And that's the person he was.
Bridget.
Willie.
Magdalena.
Lukesh.
Ida.
Rogelio.
Wilhelm.
There were different cultural pockets and neighborhoods in Reading, whether it be Polish or Slavic or Italian, but everybody got along wonderfully. You know, we saw these different people coming into the neighborhood who were either black or Hispanic, and my father, he hired everyone. And I think that's why his market was so successful.
It came in slowly from everywhere.
But things change. They always do. Became more Hispanic and Latino, and my father sold his grocery store to a wonderful Hispanic man and his family. And now the supermarket is still there. It's under a different name now, but it's still there.
Yeah, it was a good time. And then when those outlets started closing and you'd see the damage and the graffiti and the bricks thrown through the windows and the factories, well, they began closing.
When the change came,
I was born in Reading.
I was born in Reading. That Reading terminal, that train station on 7th and Franklin Station was a mecca. It was the place, and it was a real melting pot. And people came from everywhere, from the west, from the north, from the south, from the east, and they came to this place. And my father, he was a gatekeeper, if you will. And people came into the community, they saw him. He was the biggest man. He could light Lady Liberty, you know. He was a big, tall guy, and you couldn't help but see him. And he came, and he was warm, and he was welcome, loving, friendly, kind, all those things that you need to have. It's lost its life. The railroad was the life of this town because, when you know, it's like anything else. It's connecting the dots. See, everything has to, you know, okay, if you're building anything, it has to be a connection. There has to be a connection. If you're building a company, company is people, places, and things. And Reading, it lost its life when it's lost the passenger line.
I was born in Reading.
I was born in Reading in 1963.
1949, July 1st.
1913.
1951.
In the 18th Ward.
We look up and God looks down, and the experience fills us with optimism. Movement 4 is called this Reading Soars. My name is Tony Gerber. I'm a co-creator of This Is Reading with Lynn Nottage and Kate Whoriskey. Reading Soars was born of our 5 years of research in Reading, in which we heard from folks, lifelong residents of Reading, who couldn't see beauty around them. The pagoda on the hill, the freight train running north, the incredible housing stock were all reminders of a lack of agency. These were people who would leave if they could, but they didn't have the means. So Reading Soars is a gift of new vision. It will take our audience from the rural outskirts of the city, through the downtown, past the factories, smokestacks, to streets filled with school kids. It'll be accompanied by a sound score by Kashaka, and this is an excerpt from it, but what you'll see is three dancers, each on an individual location, one in a field, one on an abandoned train track. And you're not going to see that part today because we haven't filmed it yet. But these dancers will then be...
Είναι το τελευταίο κομμάτι. Είναι οι τρεις χορευτές οι οποίοι θα χορέψουν μπροστά σε ένα σιδηροδρομικό σταθμό και εμείς θα τους ακολουθήσουμε.
Thank you.
Thank you to our technicians who helped.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ τους τεχνικούς που κατάφεραν αυτό τον άθλο να βγάλουμε εδώ την εικόνα στο ταβάνι του σιδηροδρομικού σταθμού. Η σκηνή 7. Να βλέπεις και να μην σε βλέπουν. Η τελική πράξη. Την εμπνευστήκαμε μέσω της έρευνάς μας όταν θέσαμε ένα κεντρικό ερώτημα. Πώς έχουμε μια πόλη η οποία είναι κατακαιρματισμένη να συνδιαλέγεται με τον εαυτό της, να βλέπει τους γείτονες, τους άλλους, να κοιτάει ο ένας τον άλλον. Βρήκαμε έμπνευση στο θέαμα του Jumbotron, της αρένας των δημοσίων αθλημάτων, εκεί που ο κόσμος αρεσκόταν στο να βλέπει τους άλλους, τους άρεσε να βλέπουν τους γείτονες. Έτσι φτιάξαμε λοιπόν ένα στούντιο σε ένα βαγόνι και σε ένα φορτηγό και οδηγήσαμε σε όλο το Reading και εκεί είδαμε πως μεταφέροντας κάποια πορτρέτα, τα υποκείμενα κοιτούσαν και έπιαναν αυτό το βλέμμα και παρακολουθούσαν τα δικά μου μάτια για 60 δευτερόλεπτα. Και τα δικά μου μάτια μέσα από οπτικό καθρέφτη περνούσαν μπροστά από την κάμερα. Άρα στην ουσία το κοινό κοιτούσε μέσα στα μάτια του υποκειμένου και έτσι δημιουργήθηκε ένα ηλεκτρικό κύκλωμα ανθρώπινων συναισθημάτων. Εσύ τους βλέπεις, αυτοί σε βλέπουν, βλέπεις και σε βλέπουν.
I was born in Reading.
I was born in Reading in 1963.
Hello. We're just setting up for.
Λοιπόν, ετοιμαζόμαστε για το επόμενο πάνελ. Σε αυτό το στάδιο θα ήθελα να καλήσω στη σκηνή τον καθηγητή Ανδρέ Γερολιμάτο, που είναι ο διευθυντής του κέντρου του Ιδρύματος Σταύρος Νιάρχος για τις ελληνικές σπουδές, Simon Fraser University. Θα μιλήσει για την ατέρμονη πρόσκληση του κυβερνοχώρου.